Dear students, instructors and teaching assistants, ECPR Center Services managers, members of EC committee, portfolio holders, academic convener, welcome in Ljubljana, or as we say in Slovene, dobrodošli v Ljubljana. Next, I would like to ask Professor Maja Kučar, Vice Dean for Research and Doctoral Studies at the Faculty of Social Sciences, to give her welcome address.
Thank you, Samo. Warm welcome to everybody here in the audience, to the students, to the instructors, to the ECPR staff. I must say that I'm greeting you with somewhat mixed feelings today. On one hand, we are very excited to have you among our midst. On the other hand, we are a bit sorry that this being the 10th anniversary is also the last chance that we have to greet you in our midst. Still, we hope that within the time that you will be spending here at our faculty at the University of Ljubljana, that you will have a very fruitful and joyful experience. Our faculty is, as we like to brag about, the second largest among the faculties of the University of Ljubljana. The University of Ljubljana has 28 members, faculties and academies, and ours is the second. We are shrinking a bit in numbers. A few years ago, I would be able to say that there are 6,000 of us. I think now we are down to 3,000. But still, this is something one can expect in terms of a demographic change and also opening of many new spaces to students. We have, however, a good track record in terms of internationalization. We welcome every year many foreign students coming to our faculty, both through Erasmus exchange as well as through several other programs, and we are very proud of being able to host ECPR Summer School as well. Ljubljana, as our Erasmus students say, offer a lot of opportunities not only to study but also to enjoy yourselves. So I hope that among other things you will also find time to explore the city, to explore the country, and spend the time which will bring you back again to Slovenia. Again, warm welcome, as Samo said before me, dobrodošli. Enjoy the time here, spend it useful, and do come back.
I would also like to train everybody, both in Ljubljana and the others that have been sort of making this success happen. And the ECPR and the EC is extremely pleased about that. My colleague Plenary is going one or two words, but as I come from Plenary, perhaps some of you have been at the conference, together conference in Plenary in 2011, have a record attendance of 2,100. Those who were there are always welcome back. Those who haven't been should be there as soon as possible. So let me say,
thank you. I was trying to think about the metaphor in order to explain what Lafayette and I are doing here. The ECPR was born in 1970, which makes it a 45 years old, big, middle-aged, rather complicated creature. The Method School was born in 2005, which makes it a 10 years old, young, dynamic, growing, but still surprisingly big 10 years old thing. If you look at this room, this looks much more like a rather big apartment or meeting than just a single summer course. So, to put it very briefly, the mission of Olaf and I as the portfolio holders and coordinators of the New Generation Committee, to a large extent, is to somehow bring together the 45-year-old and the 10-year-old, to make them talk together and make everybody happy. So it's really a goal of coordinating largely in the administrative role, the content, the methods of that discussion comes from people in this role. So far it has been a very pleasant task for all the reasons that I've already described. I think also that the Method School has been a success in all important fronts, the increasing participation, the academic content, etc. Also the economic side of this whole thing looks good, at least right now, which gives a very good solid basis for the future planning of this activity. So, on my behalf to my warm congratulations to the 10th anniversary of the Method School, and I'm very happy to be here in the architecture.
It's a privilege to announce Professor Dierberg Schlosser, who has been chair of the ECPR Executive Committee at the time of event of Ljubljana Methods School. Now he will share some thoughts on the 10 years of development of Method Schools with us. Please, floor is open.
Dear colleagues and friends, dear summer school or Method School participants, it's a great pleasure to welcome you here all at the occasion of this 10th anniversary of the event here in Ljubljana. And I have been asked to look back a little bit, to say a few words of how it all developed, what the specificities of that kind of Method School are, and also looking at some of the further prospects. The fact that we are all here today can be traced to a glass of beer or two I had with Ojana Lobe at the occasion of the last day, the last evening of the Method School in Essex in 2005. And over these glasses of beer, and Ojana had been one of my students in the course I have been giving, and at the same time I was chair of ECPR, and as ECPR we were looking for at least a supplementary location to the Essex Summer School, because the Essex School had reached to some extent its upper limits in terms of possible numbers and possible courses, and there have been some other issues. I need to go into any details here. But Bojana mentioned, well, she could talk to her dean, who is also at the time, who is also present here tonight, Anushka Freligor. And indeed, I received an email a few weeks later saying, well, the dean was very enthusiastic about that possibility. And so we had a small mission to Ljubljana to talk to the responsible people here, to look at the facilities, and everything looked very promising. And so it all started. Well, initially, we had, I think, 6 courses and roughly 80 or 90 participants, but you can see how it has grown over the years, now to so many courses and almost 350 participants. And there has been a huge demand for all of this. And also, in a different capacity, I was and am responsible for the exercise skills on concepts and methods in the social sciences. And so IPSA also has been in similar facilities in Sao Paulo, in Singapore, in South Africa, in Ankara, and from next year onwards in Mexico City. And in fact, quite a few participants have come from one place to another, and we, by and large, all our instructors from the same pool, and it has been also expanding in the course of time. And yes, it's school participants can go from one place to another to the same instructor or another course, another instructor, and these courses are more or less mutually recognized in terms of quality and level of skills taught and required. So in this respect, it has been quite successful. What are the reasons for this? There, of course, are several, but I think 3 major factors can be mentioned. One is that this demand has increased because of the expansion of political science after the last so-called third wave of democratization in different parts of the world. This applies, of course, to Eastern European and other post-communist countries after 1989-90, but also to large parts of Latin America, some parts of Africa, and Southeast Asia. And so political science does require a certain fertile soil in order to develop and in order to prosper. It needs a minimum of academic freedom, a freedom of information, freedom of organization, critical discourse. And so, in strictly authoritarian regimes, this was not possible in most instances. And so this was one of the reasons for the expansion. I think within Europe, a second reason was the Bologna process. Even though it has some problems and downsides, but in terms of facilitating international exchanges, international mobility, but also increasing new teaching, research, employment opportunities all over Europe, but also in other parts of the world. So this can be helped, and in that context, competition increased. And both PhD students and advanced MA students and younger researchers, younger scholars, had to show their skills, and they had to expand their knowledge and their skills to have a toolbox ready for the different problems to be addressed. A third reason, I think, lies in the fact that from the very beginning, these method schools have been conceived in a pluralist manner in terms of epistemological orientations and persuasions, even to some extent in terms of ontological orientations, and develop, as you played on, let's say a few words about the plurality in that methods toolbox. And this is also in contrast to, well, still up to the present day, to the situation, for example, in the United States. There's a quantities and the qualities are still quite divided. The quantities go to Ann Arbor and the qualities nowadays go to Dr. Syracuse to take similar courses. And here from the beginning, we had this idea that it's mutually fertile to discuss different approaches, different views, and that can often supplement each other or at least create a critical understanding, even though you may not share all the epistemological or ontological positions behind it, but at least you should develop a certain knowledge about what is happening in other subfields, and so to develop that kind of critical understanding of what you are doing. And in this sense, I think it has contributed to an emancipation of European political science from what many call or call the American mainstream or the American mainstreams. In the beginning, in the 60s, 70s, mostly referring to behavioralism, later on in the 80s, 90s, referring mostly to the rational choice theories and approaches. This is not to say that these mainstreams do not have a place. They certainly have, and they have contributed a lot to our thinking, our knowledge of the world. But they have never become as dominant in Europe as in the United States, at least for certain periods. In Europe, from the very beginning, political science had very different traditions from country to country. It was much more historically oriented from the very beginning. By necessity, it was always comparative. I mean, there is such a diversity of countries and situations in Europe, so it had to be comparative. But then it also was pluralist in the sense that different positions from political philosophy, from Marxist orientations, from empirical approaches were present, and in none of our countries actually one or the other position had ever reached such a dominant position. So in this respect, this can be represented in that kind of cartoon. And here we have the different ingredients for our soup. You have certain national traditions, you have different relations to neighboring disciplines such as history, sociology, economics, in some countries also geography or social anthropology. You have different meta-theoretical orientations, different ontological, epistemological backgrounds and traditions. And OECPR has contributed to all this with these summer schools. And here you have two of the major cooks, Benoit and Bernard, who were preparing the soup here. They were appointed as directors of the summer school from the very beginning. And so in this respect, it all developed. And now it has contributed to a great deal of professionalization in the discipline. And young scholars, I think, that we see it from your reactions, from your evaluations. They are mostly very enthusiastic. They, I think, did benefit a lot, and we can see it in the careers of many of the former participants. And Bojana is not here today, but she is an instructor for next week's course. So you see there is a career pattern in that as well. And so in this respect, it has grown considerably. And I think it has contributed to the development of political science here in Europe, but now with all these exchanges and also with IPSA and in other parts of the world, this, I think, is a sign of maturity. It's a sign of respect which has been gained for the discipline. In the beginning, in some countries, at least, and I can tell from the German experience, but also from other experiences, there was some disregard, distrust, disrespect for political science, people considered it to be a purely politicized science, or had quite a number of different perceptions and prejudices, but now in all of our countries has been well established, well respected, and it has taken its place in a pluralist world of the social sciences and in a pluralist understanding of what political science is and should be. And so today we have a globalization of many things, but including a large part of political science. It's no longer the age of what was called safari research. You just go to a particular country, you conduct your study, you take the results, go back home, and you don't even inform people in that country of what you have been doing. So this age is over. And similarly, the so-called airport comparativists, so just landing for a few hours on an airport and then publishing a book about the political system of that country in a very superficial manner. All this, or most of it, at least, has changed. It's a thing of the past. And now we have in all continents, in many parts of the world, colleagues to whom we can see eye to eye in terms of their academic training, their backgrounds, their methodological skills. And so a truly international cooperation has become possible in many ways. And also it's, I think, one of the achievements of such summer schools, that international research networks, international social networks have been created and are still being created. And it's really bearing fruit over the years, and this is a testimony of what has happened.
And so in this respect, I would like to conclude with a quote from another colleague who distanced himself from a large part of American political science. And this is a quote by Philippe Schmitter, and I just read it to you. For those who want to practice political science that is critical of established power, sensitive to the distinctive nature of its subject matter, and capable of explaining the complexities of political life to real people, they would be better advised, seen from the United States, to go east, and if possible, now and then, south. That is where you will be free to question prevailing assumptions, to develop innovative concepts and methods, to address issues of significance, and maybe even to influence the course of political events. You will also be more likely to make a significant contribution to a globalized science of politics. End of quote. Thank you.
Methodological disagreement we confront. On the one side,
there is a line of thought that you can trace back further than Paul Pierce, but he has put it in a nutshell. The unity of all science consists alone in this method of its material. So to call something science, you need to give it a method. That's one position. The other position is Adorno's view, and I read out the English translation, which is out of the English translation of the book. The method risks to fetishize its cause and become a fetish itself. So, don't care about methods. Well, somewhere in between these two extremes, you will find yourself. There are excesses to methods, and there are insufficient methodologies as well. Moving forward to the recent past, let me cite a provocation a few years ago. Robert Gintis, a well-known colleague from the Santa Fe Institute. In their current state, however, according to behavioral sciences, behavioral includes everything from psychology, economics, political science, sociology. The status of true sciences is less incredible. According to Herbert Gintis, what we are currently doing cannot qualify for science. The reason he gives is what we're missing is a coherent system of thought about individual behavior, something that brings together the behavior sciences in a conceptual whole, which makes different contributions linked to each other. Whatever your, my, our position on this view is, doesn't matter here. It is a view from someone who is at the brink of being outside of the social sciences and who thinks that what we're doing has insufficient methodological, ontological, epistemological foundation to be called a science. So it's a provocation. We have to position ourselves somehow. It's something that we hope that you can learn to do at the method school is to find a position against challenges like this. Another provocation, which is less universal, but still pretty heavy. Cancer is eating at the scientific study of politics. Excessive dependence on post-liquid methods in general and linear regression in particular, we cannot predict it. Note that cancer cells are our own cells, not poisonous invaders. This is by someone who we have invited to the summer school as an instructor, who has accepted each of a course, but not a single person signed up for the course. Why does he see this way? The reams of numerical values of regression and correlation coefficient published in the science are mostly bad and rival. Once printed, no one uses them anymore, not even the authors. This is Ryan Hagenberger in a very reflective piece in European Political Science. Actually, being someone working in that paradigm myself, or having been working in that paradigm myself, I must say, doesn't this work? If you read the paper in more detail, there is really a lot of truth in the reading paper and the sequel to the paper if you use it. Now, let us turn to how do we deal with these kind of challenges? How do we put a fight of those challenges against those challenges in practice? Now, what is the start of the philosophy? What's underlying everything that you've experienced in the next 2 weeks? Three principles. First, we have to acknowledge that there's a variety of research interests. The social sciences are a broad field. There are many aspects that are worthy of studying. It depends on research interests. The kind of questions you're asking, which method is adequate? Well, therefore, you need to
know at least about the existence of a variety of methods. You don't know, need to know the details of everything, but you need to know what is there. There's a famous saying that the scientists holding a hammer sees everything as a thing. There's more, there's a whole toolkit. Perhaps you're not interested in things you can do with a saw. Yeah? Never mind, but accept that there's someone else who is interested in those kinds of things. So, accept fundamental disagreement about ontology and epistemology as a matter of time. Yeah? This cannot be solved. The different paradigms are too far apart to solve the problems, but we can work on them. We can discuss, we can meet, and we can gradually learn that the other's view is valid in itself. And that might help us to rethink our own approach. Different perspectives, so using different ontologies, using different epistemologies, will make you study different aspects of the social world, but aspects that are highly relevant. So a book that has been very influential when I was a teenager, most of you probably don't know that one. It's The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, but that's the second one. It's Persic. It's The Art of Motorcycle Maintenance. That's even older, it's the 1970s. However, there is a scene in there where, I don't remember who it was, but one of the people in there explains to the other that think of an orange. What you see, if you cut it, depends on the way you cut it. If you cut it in one dimension, you see all those, you see a flower. If you cut it in 90 degrees to that, you see slices. So depending on how you cut the object that you're studying, you will see different things. So using different methods will make you observe different things and make different statements about the social world. But all of these statements say something about the object that you're studying, right? It's still an orange. The third point is we have to respect the scientific value of other approaches. No single methodological approach can identify all aspects of the social world. Yes? We have to accept that there's a different view. Dirk has just mentioned that there's a different view in Europe to the United States in that respect. We believe that taking these three principles as a guide to developing political science in Europe will help us not forgetting that. Now, what are the dimensions that we have to look at? And I call this the ways of knowing, which is a quotation from Foucault, one of the nicest introductory methods books that I've ever come across, which is by Jonathan Moses and Thorvald Knudsen. Jonathan Moses has been one of my colleagues as organizer of the standing group Critical Methodology at the ECPR in the early years of that, before he went to do other important things. Now he is one of the editors of European Critical Science. Ways of knowing. There are different ways to cut the orange. It depends on the disciplinary perspective. Although all the social sciences have much in common with toolboxes that they're using, they are interested in different things, different aspects of the social world. Political science is all about taking decisions for probability. Sociology is all about the aggregation of individual behavior to some social facts and the way social facts affect individual behavior. Economics is all about how people relate to each other in anomalous situations. So there are lots of different things that are interesting according to different disciplinary perspective, which makes us use the common toolbox in different ways. And in that sense, I'm not haven't been having taught methods to both political scientists and sociologists in one. I tried that and I decided it doesn't really work. They have different views. Science don't. Yeah. Are we interested in regularities, or do we want to discuss sequences of events? These are completely different things, and both are aspects of the social world. I cannot elaborate on that, unfortunately. The level of analysis. Are we interested in macro phenomena, same things that happen in states, or are we interested in interactions between individuals? This will make you think differently about methods. The epistemological perspective. Are you interested in testing theories, so the empirical analytical approach? Or are you interested in developing your knowledge out of your observations in a contemplative way? Are you using quantitative or qualitative methods? I would argue, even if some this may have shouted at me, that quantitative data can be interpreted. There's a nice paper on that a few years ago in American Journal of Political Science, by the way. Data, and I call it empirical information, because not everything can be called data in the sense of a data matrix. Are you using large numbers of observations or just a small number, but in a deeper way? It will guide you towards different methods. Finally, the kind of comparisons you want to make. Are these between units, so the classical comparison, or are you studying developments within a unit, be it an individual or state, or even your system? So all these aspects affect the way you will think about methods and the kind of methods that will be useful to you. And all of these perspectives are valid in themselves. So, what can we do at the method school? Actually, after 10 years, it's you. The only thing we can do is provide you with some opportunities. We have a plenary program. We have been working on the plenary program for 10 years now. We haven't found the perfect formula yet, but it works more or less. There will be brown bag sessions, there will be methods lab this year. I invite you, recommend to you to come and see a variety of very different things. So the methods and the brown bag session, there will be a poster session, which is by people who participate, and where you will see the wide variety of approaches that are being used. They are already on display in the main corridor, so have a look. Your own opinion. The second thing we can do is provide you with space for interaction. We have all your competency rooms and works, so you are to talk to people over the evening. We have lunch use in front of coffee machines, so you have time to talk to each other. There's a cafeteria where you can go for lunch today. And whatever you come out with, tell us what you need to discuss, to meet up with people. We will try to help you as good as we can. Now, if this experience is a good experience to you, then you might want to be a teacher. We have set up the ECPR Method School about 4 years ago. And the ECPR Method School is a development of the summer school into a program which runs over the whole year. There is one event in the summer, winter. And broadly speaking, and absolutely actually in detail, in the summer school we do introductory and intermediate courses. In the winter school we do very basic and advanced courses. But what is basic? What is intermediate? We can't say that. But we have set up a program where you can come back a variety of times. You can do it in 18 months. You come to the winter school a few months after you started your PhD career. You come back in the summer school after having tested out what you did in the winter school. You come back at the winter school for an advanced course. And by that time, you will be ready to go to the field of collecting data and do the analysis. Okay? Yeah, that's what I just finally, let me end my talk with a few organizational issues that I always have mentioned at this stage. Tomorrow, some people will come to the office after the short presentations tonight, they decide that this is a no-go. Yeah, I have to go to a different course. You can do so. If there's space available in the targeted course, and if you bring the requirements for that course. So it is not, you have to come to us, we discuss with the instructor, and then we will admit you to the other course, but we will give a administrative fee for changing. So if you want to make to foster the ECPR message school, just change back and forth every day. Then we may know. Second, we have a pretty strict system of quality. There will be an evaluation at the end of the course. Please participate in that evaluation. It will end 1 year later into an award to the course with the highest scores, both in quantity and quality terms. However, that is an evaluation at the end. If there's anything you have to complain about during the course, do so as fast as you can. Okay? If it's course-specific issues, first contact the instructor, see whether you can sort out with him or her. If it doesn't work out, contact me or next week, Derek Beach will be replacing next week. For all other complaints that you might have, contact ECPR office and they will guide you through all our tech office agenda. The last resort, in all respect, is always me. Okay. So, that's the end of my talk. Let's go to the next point in our program. And we will now announce the winner of the Polar Mass Award of last year. Polar Mass has been an instructor at the summer school in the early years, the first 3 or 4 years. But unfortunately, she died. I think it was the 4th year. Polar Mass was an excellent instructor. She was always having the best evaluations for all the courses, although she taught multi-level analysis. Multi-level analysis is something you are not bound to win any competition. So when she died, we thought to commemorate Polar Mass every year by offering one of the instructors a prize, being the one who came as close to Polar Mass as it is possible for anybody who is alive. Now, last year, now I need to look into my computer. It's not something I should say. I'm citing from the evaluation, the qualitative evaluation sheet that instructor wrote. The lecture is the main reason for this being one of the best courses I've ever taken, all categories included. She was able to stimulate our interests and keep us focused and engaged every minute in the classroom. She has a remarkable ability to grant general methodological advice and specific detail about her own projects, which she paid much appreciated attention to. She has a very engaging way of teaching and is a brilliant speaker. Overall, the course is truly worth every minute of your spend on it, and all credit goes to her. However, it's also a negative note. Only wish we could have had more sessions. Now, who is this? Florian receives the award.
I am in particular overwhelmed
because I had a wonderful group of students last year. And I also want to say something else. I don't think that I would have succeeded quite as much in this course were it not for the help of Marie Croissy, who is sitting here and has come back again to help me as the course assistant.